currently working on to making some small containers called piggins with the wooden handle that you see there. Just makes it a bit more convenient for moving something in a smaller amount instead of having a rope handle where you would need two hands for filling and emptying. In this case, you would only need the one for scooping it up, dumping it out. I am currently working with white cedar, which is just one of many woods, honestly, that a cooper would use. And specifically, I'm going to use the joiner plane here and cut the angle and taper. Give you an idea. You can look at that when that's finished to that point. And you do have to determine all the correct shape all visually. That's a skill that's developed in the apprenticeship. And you're gonna run that piece of wood across the blade. And then you will gradually increase that stroke. The particular jointer I'm working with right now is a Cooper's long jointer, and we're the only ones in this time that use these long jointers where they stay stationary and you move the piece of wood across them. So the next step after using the jointer, and honestly, in the 18th century, or if you're working in a production environment, you would go ahead and joint the number of staves you think it's going to take to make that container, and then you would back all of them. So you would do it in series like that. You're not going to joint one, back it, hollow it. It works really well in a museum environment to break it up that way so you can give your audience as much of the experience as they possibly can in the short time that they're here. But in a production environment, not so efficient. So you may notice the draw bench itself. Bench being a type of foot vise, pressing down on the foot pedal brings that block forward to hold the piece of wood in place so you can work with your hands with the knife controlling how and where you want to cut. The thing to keep in mind is that you take your foot off of it, the wood can shoot into the bottom. So this is actually a very safe tool to use. The design that it is, can't come any closer to your body as long as you're keeping and using things correctly, keeping your elbows down, just like that. Again, you're going to determine that correct shape and angle by eye. And this is a backing knife. You use it to cut the back of the stave. A backing knife is probably the type of draw knife that most people run into. It has that flat surface here. There's the back. One thing to notice is, too, you're looking at the period tools, as you would definitely see where the steel and the iron were forged together. One thing you can do is you're starting as an apprentice, which I'm not going to, but you will be doing, is you would take the hoop. Actually put the piece of wood in there to make sure it's fitting. The particular draw bench that I'm working on now is actually a replica of an original that's in the Mariners Museum. And this one here that I'm working on is probably at this point about 40 years old. Not to say we put some of that in the beginning when you're first making a draw bench, but part of it is worn at this point, as I said, this is as old as it is. So it gets brought in here as well as tapered down here. And the reason that is when you're working on pieces, particularly if you're making heads, which are the bottom of the cast, that head's coming out and that knife is coming in. Now the other way to use the draw bench, besides using it in this fashion under the block, let's say you've got a piece of wood such as this one, it has some grain, it's a little irregular. Not an issue we would have had in this trade back then, as we would have only worked with quarter split stock, but there is a lip that you're cutting so you can hold the piece of wood between you and the bench. is much better. A lot of people are so used to using sandpaper now, with using modern tools or the quality of wood that's so poor, you don't have a choice, that we use sandpaper to refine that edge. But a knife is actually going to get you a much smoother surface than sandpaper if you have a good quality of wood and, of course, a sharp knife, because sandpaper is an abrasive. It's going to actually break up the fibers of the wood. You never want to sand a joint. So, you can see, cut the curve there, so that's your backing knife. A hollowing knife is where you're going to scoop out the interior. Hollowing knife, as far as we know, we're the only tray that uses a hollowing knife. Huh. And that's this one here. It's just one style. We also do have various radiuses that you can get. You can see that this one's not as pronounced. We have scorps in our tray too. There's the one-handled scorp, which you see here. And then there is also a two-handled scorp. But these are items for use once you've actually built up the walls of the container and just scooping out some uneven surfaces on the inside.
No easier way to do it.
So we actually run this over the grindstone. Okay. It's just not terribly fun. And then you can, of course, get stones that are rounded to get in there as well. Bracing or bruising the wood. Since we do work with a lot of white oak in this trade and do in the shop, we put metal bites on our blockhead to bite it, to help bite into the white oak, because white oak is so slick it can, you know, come out.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's not something you're going to want when you're working with a softer wood like cedar, because it'll bruise into the wood. To show you, right in here, I just touched it for a second. You can see where that bruising.
Absolutely.
Very quickly.
Wow.
Right now we are working with Atlantic white cedar, making a number of smaller items. The chest here is white cedar. Cedar was a very common wood in the trade along the coast, Maine down to Florida, and doing white work, domestic items, buckets, washtubs, butter churns, chests like this. And the lesser known thing, these cans, which are these wooden mugs, we know are always made out of a lighter wood. Not something that you see too much, but you would see them on ships. And these are not going to break like pottery or glass. They aren't going to corrode like a tin mug would on a ship. So they were used having a lid, flies. There's always flies or crawling on ships. This time, I tend to not do that until they're ready to go. That way, if they need to be tightened at all, if they've settled, I can do that and not messing up finish. Okay. So I actually have a number. There's a blacksmith shop here in town has requested a number of them.
Hmm.
So in that case, for the ones we've been using in town, we've been doing an experiment from the originals we've seen. We've seen where they've just been plain wood, and we've seen them where they've been lined with a pitch.
Oh.
So we are actually lining some with a pitch to kind of see what maintenance is like for that. It's not making it watertight. What it's doing is making it so you're not getting the flavor of the wood in your beverage.
Okay.
And a lot of times that's not an issue, but with beer or lower alcohol percentages, it is. And it actually can cause problems. Beer in particular, you actually do not want the flavor of wood in beer.
Huh. I mean,
it's kind of this myth that's out there that
with, you know, you always want to have, you know, white oak and, you know, and wine and brandy and all these things. Yeah. Yeah, it's great for those, but you look at alcohol content for those in particular. With beer, the tannins in white oak actually make the beer go sour. Oh. And it creates an infection. So in the past, what a brewer would do, you know, he'd buy his casks from the cooper if there was a cooperage nearby, or if not, you were having a cooper working for you at the brewery. Once the cask was completed, you would have a laborer then basically run hot brine, hot salt water through it until it ran clear to pull all the tannins out. Hmm. And then you're going to put your beer in. You still had issues because sometimes, you know, there is tannins there. Ta-da! So you still have tannins in there. And then what causes an infection, and then you have a problem of where the alcohol content drastically increases and yet the quality of the beer is worse because it tastes bad, tastes sour. Now that's a big problem when we go into the 19th century because they're actually taxed on alcohol content. So what ends up happening is in the shipping process, the beer gets a higher alcohol content, they get taxed more, and yet they have to charge less because the beer's gone bad.
Well, that's interesting.
So what they start is they line it with brewer's pitch, and that creates that problem. So it's nothing to do with making the container liquid tight, it's strictly from preventing it from becoming an ingredient.
Yeah.
They're not lighting the actual cask on fire for wine now.
Okay.
There are several steps when you are going to truss a cask. Once you get a barrel, this is a small one we use as demonstration to kind of show we're not in the process of trussing, as we don't do trussing except for in the summer months. Because we're open to the elements as we are, we can't do it on a day like today when it's raining. So we have to do it outside so we don't have what is called a corner chimney. A true cooper shop of the period or any time, you're going to have a chimney where you're actually going to be able to fit your whole cask, and it means the big cask yourself, and that way the smoke's going to go up the chimney. And what happens is you're going to build up your cask, and as you see here, this is a small one. It's at this stage when you have shaped all the staves, stacked them up into the hoops are fitting where they should, then you're ready to truss it. This is the now called a gun. It's ready to be fired. And so this is a cresset, and there's all different sizes of these, depending on the cask. The typical standard rule is that if you can fit the cresset in just barely this way through the mouth, then that's the size you want to work with. Hmm. Once we get this small, this is the smallest cresset we can make. So the cresset gets stuffed with hard wood chips. You need to have a hardwood because hardwood's going to burn hotter. And it gets packed. You don't want it packed so tightly that it can't breathe, and yet you don't want it loosely packed. And you also, on a really damp day, you want to make sure there's some air in there. But I mean, we are tamping that down. And then that would get put inside, and then what ends up happening is you would light it on the top, and it burns down. Now you're heating up the wood is the point. The point is not to get it so hot that it burns your wood. It's just heating up the wood. Think of it like we're baking it. Okay. The point isn't to burn your cake or burn your pie or whatever it is you put in there. The point is just to heat it and cook it. And it's a lot of people have this thought in their head that water is what makes wood malleable. And that is not the case. It's actually heat. Heat is what changes the molecular structure of the wood, so that it softens so you can bend it and shape it. You can use water, of course, to achieve your heat. You can use boiling water, you can use steam, because the point where the wood's molecular structure changes is at 200 degrees Fahrenheit, boiling to 12. So it's all right in there. The problem you get with using water as your method to achieve the heat is the warping that comes with it. Hmm. Which we don't want. It doesn't make a liquid tight container, and then all of our work that we put in making this joint so perfect is out the window. So we use dry heat. You have to have a better quality wood. Straight grain, no knots. Every time there's a knot or a twist and turn in the wood, that can be a crack in the cast. That's, you know, another more work yet to put into it, more time, all of this. So very good quality, only working with quarter split stock back then. Today, unfortunately, we don't get that option all the time unless we do it ourselves. So at this point, stacking that up, light that on fire, usually should only take about 10, 15 minutes to heat it up and getting it to that temperature. And we're not gonna, we're gonna feel it on the sides as we're not using thermometers. And so we're gonna feel it along the side, feeling, getting to see how hot it is. Sometimes we have to move it around. Sometimes we need to add more wood to the cresset. Rough out prior to using a joiner. So you see the big difference. Joiner plane, chopping.
Oh, ooh, that's nice. Boy, you see the sheen on that.
Yeah, Cypress, it's got a nice, and this actually did join pretty well. I don't think this side's gonna do so well. This one chops so nicely, you know, usually, and that's a, it can surprise you sometimes. And then you would just tighten it with that hammer and driver. Now I still need to make the handle. It's actually the wooden handle for this.
That's not
but right. With the barrels, yes, we always okay. needed heating before we cut the groove
okay.
on the bottom.
So you would go ahead and put it all together and then you'd do all your other, mm-hmm. cut the groove and put the bottom in, top yep. in.
And so even with these, you know, at this point, I still need to finish making the handle. This is one of those smaller containers. And then I'll replace one of these with that. And then I will tighten up all these hoops, and then I'll level it off, cut the groove, and then I'll make the bottom. And I'll use the compass to divide up the circumference of that groove. And that's how I'll know and mark it onto a couple pieces of wood to make the bottom. Once I've shaped the bottom, I'll take this hoop off. This one will stay on, but by taking this one off, we'll open up those joints enough that I can fit the bottom in from the big end to snap it into place, and then I'll put the hoop back on, tighten it all back up. Hmm. Then at that point is when we make the final hoops, and that is also part of our trade. We cut all those pieces with just a cold chisel and hammer to the length that we need, and then we will use the straight peen for actually hammering out the taper that we need to achieve, and then we'll just bend the rest of the shape over the anvil or over our knee, and then we'll bring it over here, wrap it around, mark with a piece of chalk exactly where we want to rivet the two pieces. And go rivet it, bring it back, take the old hoop, the sizing hoop off, and then replace it with the final band. Okay. All right.